Tonight, Bravo gives you the best seat in the house at a legendary music venue. From the historic Masonic Temple in downtown Toronto, Bravo presents At the Concert Hall, featuring the indie rock collective Broken Social Scene.
Hi, I'm Erica Ehm. It's been 5 years since Canadian art rockers Broken Social Scene released an album. Well, it's not like they're sitting around doing nothing. Solo albums, soundtracks, tours, and a documentary film were all part of the Broken Social Scene's agenda. Finally, they've released a new record to the delight of their fans worldwide. Forgiveness Rock Record is their latest musical vision to come to life. And tonight at the Concert Hall, we are in for a rock and roll experience. Once again, here is Broken Social Scene. I'm so excited to talk to you. First of all, Forgiveness Rock Record is the latest record, And it's interesting that once again, you have invited many friends to come and play with you. But when I listen to it, it sounds really organic. And I was wondering if you had already written a bunch of songs before you went into the studio, or are you the kind of guys that go into the studio, set up, and then just start creating?
It's a bit of both.
Yeah?
I'd say 50-50, maybe. I'd have to look at the song titles to remember exactly how each one coalesced, but...
Charlie, do you want to say anything?
I'm just the bass player.
But I'm the one who did the interview for Bass Player Magazine. But I had to say, well, actually, I didn't play bass on that song. Not on that one either.
So do you use the studio as a creative place?
Yes.
Or you already have a map already done, but you know what you're going to do?
A bit of both. You know, we come in with a rough sketch, I guess.
We set up with the gentleman right there on the piano sitting next to Andrew Wayman. John McIntyre, ladies and gentlemen, produced the record. Brought him in.
Did such a good job.
He did a fantastic job, and he took us into his life down in Chicago, and I think that's where everything really came together, because we were outside of our hometown. And
you heard you were biking around Chicago a lot?
Yeah, we were.
We were biking.
Having a little bit of a life?
It was good. It's flat. There's no hills at all. It's one of the best cities to bike in, I would say.
Yeah.
When you record your records
and
you play live, you have a lot of friends that you come and invite to play with you. What do you look for in a musician to make them a broken social scene collaborator?
Well, we got some new people. How did you guys?
It's honesty, Brendan.
Yeah, it's honesty. We really look for honesty.
And they have to be a melody addict. If they're not, they don't have a melody addiction, then chances are we won't be playing with them.
That's actually interesting, because a lot of alternative music or art doesn't really pay attention to melody. That's really important to you?
I should think so.
I know.
I should think so, too.
Yeah, you got to be singing something in the shower. Right? I mean, or humming along,
It's are we going
music.
Good cop,
it's
bad
music.
Cop?
I don't know.
You didn't warn me on that.
I don't know what our whole... I haven't figured out what our
I know, I'm
whole
really sweating.
Thing
are you hot?
It's hot as hell, I got to say.
It's hot.
I'm going to be hotter once you start singing.
The sweatshirt. Right.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you like to hear some more music from Broken Social Scene?
Can we just play music? This is very odd.
All right, I'm going to get off the stage.
Back.
Welcome back to the Conch Call with another song from Forgiveness Rock Record. Here is Broken Social Scene.
Like a joke, every step of the way. These are the Thank you. Sam Preco, everyone, go to Sam Preco.
Social scene. My name's Erica Ehm. Kevin and Brendan are in the hot seat with me. So I'm going to start to talk to you for a sec, Kevin. Okay. You started a record label with Jeff Remedios and Arts and Crafts. Mm-hmm. Tell me, why did you start the label way back when?
Brendan actually introduced Jeffrey and I, and we met in an argument about independent versus major labels one night at Ted's Wrecking Yard, R.I.P. R.I.P.
R.I.P.
And I went to a business school called Harris Institute for Music here in Toronto. And I kind of went there because I needed something to get my folks not to worry about me at 19 years of age, because I was kind of going nowhere. So I said, I'm going to go to the school. And I really wanted to have the power to say no. I didn't want anyone to be able to control anything that I wanted to do, which now is not the case entirely at all, because there's a massive empire. But Jeffrey was, as Brendan introduced him to me, you could tell that he was quite brilliant, and he was ready to make a change. And Brendan and him had a really solid relationship, and I just sort of came in, and you could tell that he was really behind us from the beginning when we were starting Broken Social Scene, correct?
Yeah, he, you know, left his job.
Yeah, he just decided to leave his job and go for it, and then he put together a wonderful team, and we put together a wonderful team, and we've been going strong since.
And now the label has gone from just you to a ton of artists, and you keep on winning awards for Best Independent Label, which is great.
Charlie just won a Juno for Happiness Project. Give it up, Charles Spirin. That's going to be our go-to. That's my go-to.
What is it that you guys are doing differently than other labels that is making such a difference?
TikTok. I think
a good collection of bands, maybe a sort of focused collection of just, you know, sort of trimming the fat, as it will.
I also think just the idea that everything was changing as the label started. So everyone who came to work there, we have a wonderful team of people working at ANC, all came there to try something new, to go with the new wave that
but
was
what
happening.
What is new? What's new?
More complications. I don't know. More frustrations, more complications, and more challenges. That's the new thing. You have to constantly be on your game. You have to constantly be trying to rethink the box and trying to figure out ways to have music heard. So you need people that are quite attentive and quite willing to do 17 jobs in one.
Okay, well, I'm going to play a little game for you. Living or dead, what musicians would be a great addition to Broken Social Scene?
Ooh, I don't want any more personally, but keep them dead. I'm cool.
Great addition, living or dead?
Because you're such great, great collaborators, and you pick such great musicians. Who would fit your band?
Thelonious Monk.
There you go.
There you go.
Whitey, come on, you got one. Yell one out.
You want to put Sun Ra in there too?
Sun Ra?
Paul Westerberg?
Paul Westerberg? Oh, he's alive. But
yeah, he's alive. You know, we'll
living
take him.
Living or dead. I mean, we work with anyone. We really do. I look forward to working with people like Mariah Carey. I look forward to working with people like Dave Matthews at some point.
I'd take Janet Jackson over Mariah.
I'd take Jan Arden over Janet Jackson. Boom.
Last question. You guys have been together
around
10 years. Now you've been together. So what's the Broken Social Scene bucket list that you haven't done yet?
Wow.
The bucket list.
We still have to raise tons of money for charities. That's what we're doing. We have a huge list of things that we want to do. And hopefully this band turns into one big charitable foundation. That's the goal. Is that not the goal, Charlie? Yeah, it sounds good to me too. We got to get the selfishness out of the music.
Broken Social Scene for the food banks.
Yeah, for Habitat for Humanity. My mom and we've been talking. We're going to try to get a charity going, build some houses, the house that music built. That's how we'll try to work with all these other people. because you know there's nothing profitable for you at all. It's all for the others. And I know that's something that a lot of people say and everything, but eventually you got to take the me and the we out of the music and go for us. And that's what we're slowly going towards.
And money. Headline the Air Canada Center.
Yeah.
Sounds good to me. Okay. Thank you so much.
I'm into that.
And that one too.
And now
would that
time
be for free? I know we're going to keep interrupting
you, Erica,
because
this is how we
do
it. You know,
I want you to play some music. I want you to play some music. Ladies and gentlemen, here they are. Thank you very much. Broken Social Scene.
Let's do it.
You were the sweetest kill.
Thanks a lot, everyone.
It all started back in 1999, when some friends in Toronto from a bunch of different bands got together to play some music.
We just happened to have this real great fortune of the talent pool that, you know, was sort of all for one and one for all.
More than a decade later, this talent pool, together known as Broken Social Scene, boasts such successful acts as Stars, take me to the Metric, and Feist.
If you have ever come to see a Broken Social Scene show or listen to the music, I mean, it's often prone to this epicness. Forgiveness Rock Record is another chapter in that sort of line of thinking.
Forgiveness Rock Record is Broken Social Scene's fourth album. With such an expansive entourage, the story of how the internationally acclaimed group came to be is just as epic.
As a general sort of movement that we kind of put together, we were doing it for the right reasons. You know, we were doing it for the love of the music. We were doing it to break out of a very, very, very structured mold.
When Kevin and I started, it was sort of going back to that initial idea of just, yeah, let's just hang out and make some music and not worrying about how you're going to market it. That's the key to our success.
Part of that success included starting their own independent music label. In 2001, Kevin Drew co-founded Arts and Crafts with Jeffrey Remedios. Through it all, friendship and community remained at the heart of the group's philosophy.
There was just this community of people in and around Toronto working with music and working with art. Photographers and filmmakers and journalists, all just interested in music and turning inwards and looking at the local community. And Broken quickly became at the center of that.
Stuart Berman is one of those journalists. He's the author of Broken Social Scene's biography, This Book is Broken.
Brendan Canning and Jason Collette, they all sort of had run-ins with that major label world and then got sort of spit out of the machine on the other end, and they were sort of feeling dejected and kind of disillusioned with the whole business of making music. So they sort of retreated and just wanted to make music for themselves. And so you had a whole bunch of people who went through the same thing all coming together in Broken Social Scene, and just, you know, I think the genuine aspect of their music really resonated with people.
In the 1990s, Canning made a name for himself playing in a Toronto band called Head. It caused such a buzz stateside that it landed them a major record deal with the now defunct American label IRS. After Head's demise, Canning joined another local group called By Divine Right, which included Leslie Feist on guitar. Around the same time, Kevin Drew and Charles Spearman were making music together under the moniker Casey Accidental.
Brendan sort of was courting me because he met me through a friend and he heard these Casey Accidental records I made with Charles.
And I jokingly said, maybe I'll make that kid a star.
Brendan was like, I need to do something. And this kid's got something.
I had just got some money from Len for doing my talking part on Steal My Sunshine. I bought a couple of pedals that really became our go-to pedals to sort of formulating the sound of Feel Good Lost. So that was kind of where it all began.
Broken Social Scene debuted on the indie rock scene in 2001 with Feel Good Lost. Not long afterward, Canning and Drew invited a bunch of their musician friends into the group, including Leslie Feist, Andrew Whiteman, Amy Milan, Jason Collette, and Emily Haynes. In 2002, they released a breakthrough record, You Forgot It in People, which earned the band their first Juno Award.
We tried to like put our thrusters on and push this thing into orbit, and the record caught gravity on its own.
A little something called the internet came along right as our, you know, anger was peaking.
Pitchfork being a large webzine based out of Chicago, they picked up on You Forgot It in People very early, and that really seemed to, you know, pour gasoline on the fire.
You Forgot It in People became a launchpad for rising solo artists and bands within the collective, and in 2006, Broken Social Scene won another Juno Award for their self-titled third album. These days, the star-studded pack is dispersed somewhat due to personal successes.
It's really this elastic entity, and you know, the whole Broken Social Scene gang is a bit like that for me, and And all of us have this common thread of not really, you know, we don't throw our anchor down because then you just have to rip it up again in a second and keep moving.
Busy schedules aside, when it came time to recording the new record after a five-year hiatus, Canning and Drew managed to rally up the all-star troupe. The difference this time around with Forgiveness Rock Record was that it was written by the band's current core six members.
We had to figure out how to kind of become a band again without those people, and Canning and I went off and made our own records and formed a band. But in 2008, when Canning's record came out, Andrew Whiteman did return, Charles Spearin did return. It was really the six of us, and we toured all over the world. Texico Bitches, I think you found a friend. What happened was there became a sense of us wanting to do this again. That's how we came into making this record, and the funniest thing is now on this album, I think there's 31 people who ended up on it, which I think is our biggest list so far.